Hello friends, in this session we will learn about the welded joints. Welded joints are inseparable part or element of day-to-day life. We see there are many welded connections right from our two-wheeler, four-wheeler to aeroplane. Even many household applications are also welded. So we will see the design of welded joints. Now welded joint design actually includes determining the length of weld that will be needed, the strength of weld, and its evaluation using different theories, different standards. So first of all we will define welded joints. Welding is a process of joining metallic parts by heating to a suitable temperature with or without application of pressure. In this, the two metals which are to be joined are of generally same material. It may not be the case, but they should be they are of same material. A welded joint can be a substitute for a riveted joint. It also can be an alternative method for casting and forging. As it is said that welded joint can be used as a substitute for riveted joint. Riveted joint is a temporary joint which may consider high strength applications like bridges, etc. And welded joint is basically a permanent joint. There is no separation, dismantling of the parts which are joint. We will see some advantages and limitations of welded joints as compared with the riveted joints. Riveted joints require additional cover plates, gusset plates, straps, clip angles, and large number of rivets that increase the weight. As there are no additional parts, the welded assembly results into lightweight construction. Now when we compare riveted and welded joints in terms of weight, so when we are actually riveting a plate, we will require, as mentioned, the gusset plates, the cover plates, the straps, clips, angles, and n number of components. That is actually increasing the weight of the overall assembly. Further, in case of welding, there are no additional parts, only filler material is there, and welded assembly only two parts that are welded, and hence the welded assembly is light in weight construction. Cost of welded joint is lower than riveted joint, obviously, as it requires much less operations than riveting. So design of welded assemblies can be easily and economically modified to meet the product requirements. It basically explains or mentions the nature and type of weld gun to meet the product requirements or to meet the product dimensions, changes in the overall shape and sizes of the components. Welded assemblies are tight and leak proof as compared with riveted assemblies. Now we can see the petrol tanks, even the water tanks, these are all welded and leak proof. Generally welding gives a tight and leak proof joint as compared with riveted assemblies. Production time obviously will be less for welded assemblies. Now in riveting, there is process of drilling holes, which is not included in assemblies, in welding. Hence, the production of welded joints requires or consumes less time. Further, in riveted joints, the holes are drilled. These holes actually result into stress concentration in parts, in the mating components. So, as the material is removed, the stress concentration is there, and there is no such issue or problem with the welded one. Welded structure has smooth and pleasant appearance. However, in case of riveted joint, there is a projection of rivet head that is hampering the appearance of rivet. Possesses high strength. The welded joint generally possess high strength than riveted joint. Now, it is a relative advantage. As we are learning welded joint, we will say that it will possess high strength, but in some applications, rivet surpasses the weld strength also. Machine components of certain shape, such as circular steel pipe, find difficulty in riveting but can easily be welded. So, these are some advantages of welded joints over riveted joints. Now, we will see some advantages of welded structures with cast iron structures. Now, first advantage is again a weight comparison. Welded joints are light in weight than cast iron structures. Designer has more freedom and flexibility in designing welded assemblies, as no ultimate strengths are involved. Welded assemblies are more easily machined than castings. Capital investment for a weld shop is less than a foundry shop. These are very easy to understand, so I am not explaining much about the advantages and disadvantages. So we'll move on to the disadvantages part. Capacity to damp vibrations is lower than that of a cast iron structure. It is well known that the cast iron structures are used to damp vibrations, and this is the disadvantage, that welded joint lacks this property or capacity. Welding results into thermal distortion of parts, including residual stresses. Obviously, so in welding, high temperatures are involved that results into thermal distortion of parts, including the residual stresses. High stress relieving is required in welded structures, but not in riveted ones. Further, quality and strength of weld depends upon the skill of the welder. This is a, we can say, highest disadvantage. But nowadays, robots are being used for some welding operations, so the quality and strength is enhanced. Inspection of welded joints is more specialized and costly than riveted joints. Now, with development of Industry 4.0, these processes will be automated. Now, fundamentally, there are two types of joints: welded joints, butt, that is end to end, and fillet joints, that is lap joint. So we will see one by one. Butt joint, it can be defined as a joint between two components lying approximately in same plane. That is, if you see, you observe these figures. First is a square butt joint, figure A. Figure B shows V butt joint, here the plates are bit beveled. U butt joint, double V butt joint, and last one is V joint with backing strip. Now, why these five types of butt welds exist? They are existing, or they are into existence, because of variable plate thickness. We will see. So, as mentioned, butt joint connects the ends of two plates. First, when the thickness of plate is less than 5 mm, it is not necessary to bevel the plate edges as shown in figure A. Edges are square with respect to plates, so it is called as square butt. Now referring to figure B, when the thickness of plates is in between 5 to 25 mm, the edges are to be beveled before welding operation. Edges of two plates form V shape. Slight beveling operation is needed, so they form a V shape, so the joint is called as V joint. Again, it is a V butt joint. Third one, when the thickness of plates is more than 20 mm, edges of plates are machined to form a U shape. The joint is welded from one side. This is U butt joint. Again, fourth one, when the thickness of plates is more than 30 mm, double welded V joint is used. The joint is welded from both sides of the plate. When the welding is to be done only from one side, a single V joint with a backing strip is used to avoid the leakage of molten metal on the other side. So there is a specific purpose of the V joint. Then we move on to fillet welds or lap welds. So fillet or lap welds are nothing but a lapped connection. Okay, lapping is one upon another. So fillet joint or a lap joint is a joint between two overlapping plates or mechanical components or components. There are two types of fillet welds. First is transverse fillet weld. So direction of the weld is perpendicular to the direction of force acting on the joint. Now you understand the context of transverse fillet weld. The direction of weld is perpendicular to the direction of force acting on the joint, and it is independent of the plate orientation. Okay, so there are single transverse and double transverse. Further, there is another type of lap joint that is called as parallel fillet weld. A fillet weld is called parallel or longitudinal if the direction of the weld is parallel to the direction of force acting on the joint. Here you observe these diagrams. Single transverse fillet weld, you see the force. This is the single fillet. This is the top view of the weld. So here you can observe the load direction is perpendicular to the weld. Okay, so this is what single transverse fillet weld. Moving ahead, we will see double transverse fillet weld. So for double transverse fillet weld, the welds are shown on both top and bottom part also. So this is the top view. Here you can observe that the load direction is again perpendicular to the weld. Okay, then we'll see parallel fillet weld. So if you observe this figure for parallel fillet weld, you see the direction of force. This is P, and again this one is P. Here the weld location is shown, this hatched portion. So this is the weld. So direction of weld is parallel to the load applied. So this is called parallel fillet weld. The diagram is for double parallel fillet weld. Then we will see the cross sections of fillet weld. Now when we say cross sections, it is the skill of welder. So generally there are two types: normal cross section and convex cross section. If you observe the diagrams, for normal cross section it would include an isosceles triangle, whereas for convex cross section there is a slight bulge or semicircular portion. So we'll see each of them. Normal weld consists of an isosceles triangles, whereas convex weld requires some more filler material and more labor. There is more stress concentration in convex as there are sharp edges, as compared with the convex one. Okay, now we'll see the strength equations. Okay, so first we'll see the strength equation of butt welds. What actually is the strength? What is the strength of weld? We will see. So it is nothing but equating the load applied to the weld dimensions. So if you refer this figure for butt weld in tension, we observe few things. The height is h, the load direction is shown perpendicular, this is weld, length is l, the load, the tensile force is p, h is the throat of the butt weld and l is the length. Okay, now moving ahead, the average tensile stress in the weld. To understand the term average tensile stress, okay, so here sigma t is equals to p by h into l, so it is the tensile area, this is h into l, this is the area of weld. Okay, so stress is equals to load upon area. So this is equation 1. Throat of the weld does not include the bulge or reinforcement naturally. So reinforcement is provided to compensate for the flaws in the weld. Equating the throat of the weld edge to the plate thickness, because plate can't be welded beyond plate thickness. So we have to equating the throat of the weld to the plate thickness T. The strength equation of butt joint can be written as P is equals to sigma T into area, that is T into L, where sigma T, this is equation 2, where sigma T is the permissible tensile stress for the weld. Further, there are codes for welds also. Certain codes, like code for unfired pressure vessel, suggest reduction in strength of a butt welded joint by a factor called as efficiency of the joint. So we need to multiply the strength equation by efficiency, that is P is equals to sigma t, that is tensile stress into thickness, T into length of the weld into efficiency. So this is equation 3. So this is what strength equation of butt weld when we have considered efficiency. So I hope equation 2 and 3 you have understood. Then we will move on to the next derivation part, that is strength of parallel fillet welds. So if you observe the strength of parallel fillet welds, so you first of all we need to understand the diagram. The length of the weld is denoted by L, the force applied is P, and it is parallel to the direction of weld. Okay, figure B and C, it is representing the throat and height of the welds. Then further we'll move on to the derivation part. A parallel fillet weld that is subjected to tensile force is shown in first figure, that is figure A. Dimensions as mentioned of the weld are leg H, throat T. Okay, then cross section of the weld, fillet weld, consists of a right angle triangle having two equal sides. Length of each of the two equal sides is called as leg. As a rule, the leg H is equals to plate thickness. Throat dimension is the minimum cross section of the weld located at 45 degree to the leg dimension. Therefore, T is equals to H cos of 45. that is T is equals to 0.707 H. So now we have relation between T and H as 0.707 H. Failure of the fillet weld occurs due to shear along the minimum cross section area of the throat, that is at 45 degrees. Shear failure of the weld is indicated in figure B. So cross section area of the throat is T into L, that is T is 0.707 H into L. Shear stress in the weld is tau is equals to P, that is load, upon shear area. For equation 5, P is the load applied, the force applied, and 0.707 H into L is the shearing area. So again, rearranging equation 5, we will get P is equals to 0.707 H into L into tau. This is equation 6, which includes L as length of the weld. Again, as usually there are two welds of equal length on two sides of the vertical plane. So we will multiply the equation 6 by 2. Hence we get P is equals to 2 into 0.707 into H into L into tau, where tau is the shear stress, that is 1.414 HL tau. This is equation 7. Now equation 6 and 7 are the strength equations. Moving ahead, further to determine the weld length, we need to make provision for starting and stopping of weld run. It is not that the moment you put the weld torch or gun on the part to be welded, it will start welding. So usually 15 mm should be added for starting and stopping of the weld run. As per the American Welding Society code, that is a code of AWS, given by American Welding Society, the shear stress value tau is equals to 94 newton per mm square is taken for static load in fillet welds. So this is the strength equation for fillet weld. Now we will see the strength of transverse fillet welds. In this case, the minimum area of failure is again throat area. Here if you see or observe this diagram, the load P is acting perpendicular to the direction of weld. So L is the length of weld, H is the height or leg dimension, T is throat. Failure of fillet weld, the figure indicates the failure of fillet weld. So a transverse fillet weld subjected to a tensile force P is shown. Minimum cross section of the weld is at throat. Hence, failure due to tensile stress occurs at this section. Then cross section area of the throat is T into L. Therefore, the tensile stress in the transverse fillet weld is sigma T equals to P upon T into L. As we know, T is equals to 0.707 H. We get sigma T is equals to 0.707 H into L, that is equation 8. Rearranging equation 8, we will get P is equals to sigma T into 0.707 H into L, where sigma is the permissible tensile stress for the weld. Generally, as we know, there are two plates. So again, we are going to multiply the equation 9 by 2, that will give P is equals to twice of sigma t into 0.707 H into L, that is 1.1414 H L sigma t. So this is the strength equation of fillet weld, that is transverse fillet weld. I hope you have understood and enjoyed this session. Thanks for watching.